Great. Hello and welcome, everybody. Thank you for joining us today in the latest of our Lutheran Services in America Strength and Service series. We are delighted today to have Héctor Colón, who is not only a visionary leader within our network as president and CEO of Lutheran Social Services of Wisconsin and Upper Michigan, but he's also an author of the book From Boxing Ring to The Boardroom, Five Essential Virtues for Life and Leadership, in which he tells his incredible story, which starts from first being an international boxer and then to reach and head one of the largest nonprofits in the Midwest. So today we'll have a very interactive webinar. It's intended to be interactive and to involve everybody. And we'll hear from Héctor and then go into breakout rooms where we can discuss each one of the virtues. Héctor, it's a delight to welcome you. Thank you so much for doing this today.
Thank you so much. Just gonna get this, get this up here. Thank you, everyone. I'm really looking forward to bringing out the champion in you today. One of the greatest heavyweights to ever grace the ring once said, champions aren't made in the gym. Champions are made from something they have deep inside of them, a desire, a dream, a vision. I see many parallels between becoming a champion and a leader. Successful champions and leaders work really hard to obtain our status. Successful champions and leaders work really hard to maintain and elevate our status. And successful champions learn how to bob and weave and roll with the punches and sometimes even take it on the chin in order to advance their careers. Over the next 25 minutes, I'm going to share with you how five virtues helped me become the person that I am today. And I am confident that they will bring out the inner champion in you. First, let me start off by telling you a story of a little young boy. This little young boy was bullied in his neighborhood for years because of the color of his skin. One time he came home with a bloody nose and told his father that the boy Adam hit him in the face, called him a spick, the N-word, and told him to get out of the neighborhood. This little young boy's mother and father got a divorce when he was 12 years old, and his father moved to Puerto Rico. No calls, no support, completely gone. His father that this young boy loved so much. This young boy was 12 years old at the time, and his sister was 17, and she became addicted to drugs, had a traumatic experience, and had also co-occurring mental illness. This little young boy's sister was in and out of jail, in and out of the psychiatric hospital. Fights between her and my mother, all in front of this little young boy. Drugs and gangs permeated this young boy's surroundings. Two of his best friends died due to drug overdose. His favorite cousin died due to gang violence. This young boy's mother was working sometimes two and three jobs to support the family. Sometimes this young boy was home alone, just trying to figure it out. As a result of these factors, this young boy has an A score of 6. With an A score of 6, it would indicate, research would indicate that this young boy would have 1,200% likelihood of having depression or a 200% likelihood of committing suicide. This young boy is me. I'm so thankful to my coach, Israel Acosta, who they call Shorty, who is truly a giant in my life. He has been a giant in our community, and he has created many champions in and out of the ring. And he instilled in me these virtues to help me overcome the challenges I had as a young child. And they are magnanimity, which is about striving for greatness. Humility at its core is about serving others. Courage, which is about facing your fears and fighting to do the right thing. Perseverance, which is about not giving up. And temperance, which is about self-control and restraint. First, magnanimity. Here, St. Thomas Aquinas, who is a philosopher and theologian, says that the magnanimous person seeks to do great acts, things that are deserving of honor. Alexander Havard, the author of Created for Greatness, says personal excellence is the ultimate aim of magnanimity. I believe that it is the daily habits, routines, and rituals that, and taking a mind, body, spirit approach that helps you achieve this virtue. I know many of you are busy. You have budgets. You have crisis situations that come up, family matters. You have a pandemic. You have lots of distractions that occupy your time. When I was a boxer, I had lots of distractions as well, but I wanted to become the champion. And as a boxer, I would wake up every morning and I would go running at 5 o'clock in the morning. It didn't matter if it was below 0 degrees. It didn't matter if there was 6 inches of snow. I was out there running and I would do a lot of self-talk. And I would say, Vernon Forrest, who was my fiercest competitor who lived in Georgia, I would tell myself that he's not running in the snow and he's not running in this below 0 degrees. And I would work out in the afternoons, lifting weights. I would work 2 to 3 hours in the evening. Throughout the day, I would pray and reflect to get my mind right. I would go to sleep early. I would wake up early. I was eating right. I was sacrificing. I was doing everything that I could to become a champion boxer. Those daily rituals, those daily routines, that virtue of magnanimity that I learned in boxing is what helped me become a 7-time national champion in 6 different weight classes. And I traveled all over the world with the United States national boxing team. And in 1992, I was favored to go to the Olympics as a welterweight. I was so excited. I was 19 years old. I was already looking at the gold medal. I was already going beyond and looking at that lucrative multi-million dollar contract that I was going to eventually achieve. And for the most important opportunity of my life, I was not focused, mind, body, and spirit. I was distracted and I lost in the Olympic trials. And I was devastated. I wasn't hearing from the big time promoters about the $1 million contracts. And I was hurt and I was searching and I was searching. And on December 27, 1992, I bought my first Bible and I gave my life to Christ. And my life was so blessed. I continued to box. And 6 months later, I fought Jesse Brasino again. Jesse Brasino is the guy that beat me and robbed me of my opportunity to be in the 1992 Olympics. And this was the outcome. That fight was on cable television. I came out on the front cover of USA Boxing Magazine, inside cover of Sports Illustrated, and the promoter started coming back and wanted to talk to me about turning professional. But I immersed myself into the scriptures and I immersed myself into the church, and I ended up feeling a strong calling away from the sport. There was one scripture in particular in 1 Corinthians chapter 6 where it talks about we are temples of the Holy Spirit. What we do to ourselves, we do unto God. And I imagine myself a temple of the Holy Spirit going into that ring and hurting someone as well as hurting myself. And that was the scripture that convicted me. And I ended up leaving the sport. It was the hardest decision I ever made in my life. But something that I worked so hard for was literally at the tip of my finger. But that same dedication, determination, and discipline it took me to become a champion boxer is the same dedication, determination, and discipline that I apply into my life, striving for excellence, that virtue of magnanimity, those daily rituals, those daily habits to help me be the best I possibly can be, just like when I was a boxer. And as a CEO, now I'm trying to be my best. I try to follow a rigorous plan of life where I wake up every morning and I start off with gratitude, thanking God for all the beautiful things I have in my life. And then I work out and I listen to motivational videos about courage and fighting to do the right thing for others. And I get motivated and I have daily mass and pray and read spiritual reading, scripture, professional development. These are all the things that I do, my daily rituals and routines, just like I used to be when I was a boxer, but now I'm doing it to be a better father, to be a better husband, to be a better CEO. I end my day with an examination of conscience where I ask myself, what did I do well today? And I cherish that. And I try to tell myself, I want to do more of that tomorrow. What didn't I do so well today? And then I want to ask why. And I do well. I want to dig into the root cause of that situation so I can learn and become more self-aware of the situation and commit to not making that mistake tomorrow. And so when you practice the virtue of magnanimity, it will not only impact yourself and make you better, but it will impact your family, your team, your community, allowing you to do something that is honorable and remarkable for those that surround you. I'm going to ask a question right now. We're going to go out to breakout sessions later, but reflect on this question and provide input at the breakout sessions. Really think about what the virtue of magnanimity means in your life. What are your daily habits, your daily routines and rituals? Are they the right things that will help you achieve your best self? Humility. In Matthew chapter 20, it says, just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life ransom for many. Whether you believe if Jesus Christ is our Lord and Savior or not, he is arguably the most influential person in the history of the world. And he came as a humble servant leader. He didn't come as ruler or dictator. He came by loving us and showing us a way of life by serving others. And when I think about humility, I think about the term fraternal humility, with its origin in the Greek and Latin and Christian world. And it's about service to others. We all have special people in our lives that have served us throughout the years. Maybe it's a parent, maybe it's a coach, maybe it's a mentor, somebody that has served us, that have made us the person that we are today. When I think about this virtue, I think about my mother, who worked 2 and 3 jobs to support the family when my father left, and she never complained. Not once did I hear my mother complain. In fact, if we would complain about my father, she would stop us in his tracks and she would say, stop complaining about your father. He loves you, even though we didn't hear from him. And my sister had a mental illness and she had boyfriends that would have a mental illness. And my mother would serve them, would make sure that they had clothes, make sure that they had food, would make sure they would take their medications, would do everything a paid case manager would do out of the love that exuded from her heart. She never received a dime, but she loved serving others. You know, we would take in homeless people. I remember one time where we had I was about to eat some rice and beans in a pork chop. And my friend DJ came over. My mom said, stop, you know, share that with DJ. So we learned how to be generous with others. She taught me how to give to others, how to serve others. I love my mother so much. I learned so much from her humble servant heart. When I think about this virtue, I think about about my coach, Israel Acosta, Shorty, who is a giant in this community, has been a giant in my life. He spent his nights with me, sacrificed his nights for me and his weekends. And so, and he took me into his own home where he loved me, fed me, and made sure that I could become a champion in and out of the ring. You know, right now, as a CEO, you as leaders, you have people that continue to serve you. You know, I have an executive assistant, Melissa, who serves me so well. Does, you know, she tries to make sure that I have what I need to be successful. And I am so appreciative of everything that she does for me. And I have direct reports that provide me with great assistance and support, and they serve me. And I feel so honored and proud to be surrounded by these great leaders. And when I think about them, they remind me of my mom and of Shorty, of the great humble servant leaders that they are. And when I'm reminded about my mom and Shorty, I want to make sure that I'm serving them as well as they're serving me. And it's very important. I want to make sure, so how can I do that? How can we do that as leaders? Because you have individuals that serve you as well. So, you know, I try to make sure that they are doing well, that I'm concerned about their personal and professional lives, that I'm recognizing them for the great work that they do, that I'm paying them as well as we possibly can pay them for the value that they provide me as well as this organization. And that we are, you know, a CEO usually comes in and provides, you know, it's our job to provide the vision, the strategy, and the direction, and then ask, you know, your team to execute. You know, I don't do it that way. I ask my team for their input. I ask my team for their advice. I ask questions, and they give us valuable insights. And together, we are co-creating our future. Along with my team, we're developing this servant leadership culture with altruistic motives. There are ways that I'm trying to figure out each and every day, how can I serve my team better? Because I want to do honor my mother and Shorty the way they have served me in my life. So think about a time where you exhibited the virtue of humility. How did this affect you and them? Is there a person in your life right now that you can serve better? If so, how? Courage. Here, one, according to Abraham Lincoln, here one confronts a multitude of things that terrify people: fear of criticism, fear of embarrassment, fear of poverty or job loss, fear of losing friends or being ostracized, even fear of being seen in the wrong. As leaders, we are often faced with difficult decisions that require us to face our fears and sometimes even fight to do the right thing. I know you. I've heard from you directly. You have to fight for resources. You have to fight for your staff. You have to fight for the people we serve. You have to fight the racial and ethnic injustices that happen in our communities. I've learned so much from you, and I thank you, and I encourage you to share more of those stories of courage that each and every one of you have had and live out on a daily basis. I learned what it means to fight. There's no greater courage than entering into that ring. That fear that you feel entering into that ring is just terrible. I don't care who you are, Mike Tyson, Evander Holyfield, the greatest to have ever graced a ring, have fear. And if they don't tell you they have fear, they're lying. But they get into that ring with confidence because of that dedication, that determination, and that discipline, that self-preparedness that gives them confidence to get into that ring. And I have to tell you, there's nothing like having those hands raised in victory in front of thousands of people. but you know you were proud because you worked so hard to get into that ring. And I have to tell you that that courage helped me so much in life. You know, when I was about to, I was recruited for to be the director of Health and Human Services for Milwaukee County. And I remember some of my friends and some mentors telling me, Héctor, don't take that job. It's political suicide. You know, at the time, people were dying in hospital. You know, they were running multi-million dollar deficits. There was fraudulent situations that were reported in the news. It was the biggest department in county in Milwaukee County government. They thought I shouldn't do it. And then, but I had a great mentor of mine, said, Ricardo Diaz, who approached me and said, look, this is a great opportunity. You can make a difference. Have courage. And I had courage and I took the job. And I remember being in that job at first. Lots of reforms were needed in the mental health system, the criminal justice system, and the housing, disability services, all of that. And I remember the courage of Chris Abley, who was my boss, the county executive, when we decided we were going to close the long-term care institution. Probably one of its, the only one that probably existed in the United States of America, where we were warehousing people with mental illness. And we decided that we were going to close the long-term care and to do it within 3 years. And people were telling Chris Abley, don't do this. This is going to ruin your reelection. Héctor Colón, don't take it so serious. This is a stepping stone. Chris Abley, these people are going to die in the community. Héctor Colón, these people are going to kill people in the community. And we didn't hear that. We wanted to do the right thing, but we surrounded ourselves with so many people. Randy Olzak, who's my chief financial officer, worked with me at the county. Michelle Naples, who's on the call as well. She's our chief integration officer, worked with me at the county. We brought in leaders from the community, persons with lived experience, national leaders in the space, and we moved forward with courage, even though I was threatened to not be reconfirmed as the director of Health and Human Services by the county policymakers. But this was worth moving forward with. This was worth doing because we were doing something for individuals that didn't have a voice. And when we closed that, we allowed these individuals to live in the community, close to their loved ones and families, an opportunity that's afforded to the rest of us. It also allowed these individuals now to live in accordance with the law. We were sued in the past for institutionalizing people that should be in a least restrictive setting in a community of their choice. These people now have better outcomes than we've had when they were institutionalized, and the county saved millions of dollars in the process. Although I almost wasn't going to get confirmed, it was worth fighting for and doing the right thing, along with so many others in this community, to accomplish this great accomplishment. You all have done many acts of courage, and I applaud you for that. I know that. I've heard the stories. I want you to think about a time where you acted with courage. Who or what motivated you to act with courage? What difference did you make in the life of another person, your family, organization? How did that affect you in a way? Wait, how does that affect the way you lead courage today? Perseverance. Here, according to Nelson Mandela, difficulties break some men, but make others. No axe is sharp enough to cut the soul of a sinner who keeps on trying, one armed with hope that he will rise even in the end. Every day, leaders like you are required to not be afraid of losing. But in our sector, that is so hard. You know, we can't fail. We have the taxpayers, we have policymakers, we have our staff, we have boards, we have the people we serve We can't fail. We have no margin. There's no room for failure in our sector. And I believe that that is why we're not reaching our full potential. You know, I have failed lots of times in my life, and they have helped me become the person that I am today. I talked about boxing. I lost my first fight and I wanted to give up. I fight my second, but my coach said, don't give up, champ. You could become a champ. You got natural abilities, he told me. So I fight my second fight and I lost again. And I really wanted to give up, because here you're going into that ring with this intense fear. There's nothing fun about that. Then you lose. And then you start crying and you're humiliated. So there's nothing fun. And I told my coach, I said, I'm done with boxing. He said, champ, don't be a quitter. Don't be a quitter. Don't be a quitter. You can become a champ. Stick with it. And it was the way he said it that encouraged me to continue with it. And look, I became a 7-time national champion, competing all over the world with the United States national boxing team. I was afforded opportunities to meet great people in Poland that weren't bullies, like the bully that bullied me in the neighborhood. I got to get a worldwide perspective. I was in Russia and Germany and Ireland and Scotland and all these beautiful places that I would have never been if it wasn't for the sport of boxing. The virtues that I'm talking to you here today came and were inspired from the sport of boxing. And then when I quit boxing, I wanted to become an occupational therapist. And so I take my entrance exam and I scored embarrassingly low. I was taking basic arithmetic and they asked me to take study courses, and it was embarrassing, but I persevered. I worked so hard and I graduated with honors. I got a 3.83 for my master's degree, and I was the only student in my class to publish my thesis in the American Journal of Occupational Therapy. Then I take my first occupational therapy entrance exam so I can start practicing occupational therapy. I was excited. Now I'm going to have a job and I can help my mother pay the bills and I can help other people. And I take my first test and I failed. I didn't study at all because I thought, I'm an honor roll student. I'm smart. I really know this stuff. And it was a big mistake and I failed. So then I studied a little bit more because I just barely failed. And I failed one more time. And I was really hurt. It was like an 8 count. And I was like, what just happened? I can't pass this test. And at the time I saw Vernon Forrest, who I beat twice, become a 4-time world champion, multimillionaire. I saw Jose Antonio Rivera, who I beat by knockout, become a 3-time world champion, millionaire. And I thought to myself, I can't pass this test. What am I doing? Why don't I go back to boxing? It would be so much easier for me. And then I heard Shorty, that echo, that giant say, don't be a quitter. Don't be a quitter. Do not be a quitter. And this time I studied with the rigor and intensity. It took me to be an honor roll student to pass this test. And the third time I passed. But if I would have given up, you know, I've had so many great opportunities with that occupational therapy degree, opportunities that led to the rise to eventually becoming the CEO at LSS. But my rise was difficult. There were a couple opportunities that I thought I should have gotten, CEO opportunities. And it wounded me, the last one that I didn't get, because I thought I was going to get it. And I was hurt and I was questioning, can I become a CEO? Will I become a CEO? And I dug down and I practiced leadership. I surrounded myself with people. I had mentors. I got CEO mentors. I got a business coach. I was reading. I was practicing leadership. As the director of health and human services, where we turn multi-million dollar deficits into multi-million dollar surpluses with major reforms. If I would have given up, I wouldn't be the CEO at LSS right now. I'm so glad that I didn't give up, because this is such a great opportunity for me now to be in this wonderful organization with a history and legacy of accomplishment, over 138 years of providing services to the most vulnerable. Last year served 30,000 individuals, 91% of which indicate that we have improved their quality of life. I am surrounded by 800 humble servant leaders that I learn from each and every day. If I would have given up, I would not be giving this presentation to you here today. Perseverance is about not giving up. Think about one challenge worth taking on in your life right now. What are the three things that you could do to live out the virtue of perseverance in addressing this challenge? Self-control, temperance. Temperance is about self-mastery. Everything we experience in our bodies and souls should be given free rein, nor ought we do everything we can do. It is easier to let ourselves be carried away by so-called natural impulses, but the road ends up in sadness and in isolation in our misery. That's from St. Jose Maria Escriva. You know, we are all humans. We all have temptations, people, or situations that makes our lives vulnerable. And at times we could lose self-control. You know, in the sport of boxing, you learn self-control. You know, before a fight, there's a lot of bad talking back and forth, and they try to get to your mind, but you have to have self-control and be calm and composed and not allow that to get to your mind. You know, when you're in that ring, it's not a fight. If you get hit, you can't get mad. You have to strategize, you have to compose yourself and think about how are you not going to get hit again. And you have to have lots of self-control. You cannot get mad. Or if you get hit with a low blow and the referee doesn't see it, you can't retaliate with a low blow, because now the referee might see it and you could get disqualified. So I learned lots of temperance and lots of self-control in boxing. And we need more temperance in our world more than ever. Look at our politics. Look at our challenges. If we had more temperance and self-control, I think we'd be a better nation. Now, I want to share an example. When I was at the county, we were looking to privatize our community support programs for people with mental illness. The majority of them were already privatized. We just had a couple remaining in the county. And I was making the case in a county board meeting about how, you know, we would save $1 million. The private sector was serving higher acuity individuals, more challenging situations, and the private providers had slightly higher quality metrics. So it just really made sense. I provided all the data and we were going to move forward because we needed to the savings so that we could reinvest in our staff and reinvest in other community-based services. So I made the case and my team made the case, and all of a sudden one union person, you know, comes up to speak, and he says, "Hector, of all the people that should understand, it's you. We served your sister through the Southside CSP. You should know the good services that we have provided her. Why would you do this?" And I didn't ask for permission, and I got up, and this was on televised cable television, and I told him, I said, "Who gave you the right to talk about my sister? That's a HIPAA violation. You should know better. You shouldn't talk about my sister." I said, "Don't you ever do that again. You hear me?" And then the county chairperson interrupted me and told me to sit down, and because I didn't have permission to speak. And I was so upset. As I came back to my office, I called my staff and I said, "I want them fired tomorrow." And then we had a short conversation. I get back into my office And I started driving back home and I started reflecting on it. And I called her back and I said, look, let's not fire yet. I want to think about this tonight. And I want to reflect on it. Now let's talk tomorrow morning. I prayed on it. I thought about it. And I realized that this person was a good person. The Southside CSP did help my sister a lot. They helped her overcome her addiction. They helped her stabilize with her mental health challenges. This person did good work for my sister. And I felt that he doesn't deserve to be fired. And he shouldn't be fired. And so as I came back the next morning, I told my staff, I don't want him fired, but I want to talk to him. And we talked on the phone and we disagreed about the privatization issue, but I knew his heart was in the right place. And he knew that my heart was in the right place. I could have fired him and that would have been a lack of control and temperance that would not have been the right thing to do. And I'm so glad I didn't do that. Now let's think about temperance. When faced with adversity or personal struggles, what are the tools that you use to help you maintain self-control and temperance? Consider the physical, the mental, and the spiritual tools. How do you use these tools to help you practice more temperance? Now, I want to summarize these virtues, starting with magnanimity. I want to encourage you to go strive for excellence. Make a difference in the world that is remarkable and honorable. Apply daily rituals, daily habits, and daily routines that's going to help you live out this virtue. Humility. Go out there and serve others. The more you serve others, the more you're going to get in return. Courage. Go out there and face your fears. Fight to do something that will yield extraordinary results for others. Perseverance. Go out there and fail. Yes, I encourage you to go out there and fail and learn from those failures, because if you're not failing, you're probably not reaching your full potential. And temperance, control your natural impulses, control your emotions, especially on things that you cannot control. Do not react to a situation that can ruin your life and your career. So now we're going to go into the breakout sessions. There are, Michelle Naples is going to lead the breakout session on magnanimity. Bridget is going to lead out the breakout session on humility, Joel on courage, Sharon on perseverance, and Jackie on temperance. So now we'll go into the breakout sessions. I look forward to, and then when you come back, there'll be you'll report back on what you guys talked about, and then we'll close. Thank you. Well, I hope you had great breakout sessions and those opportunities brought out the champion in you. So now we'll get some report backs, and maybe starting off with magnanimity. Michelle, would you like to share what was discussed in your session?
We had a nice discussion around magnanimity, and everyone could say it perfectly. So that was impressive. Some of the themes that came up were just really taking a moment to stop and pause and be intentional about, you know, those things that we could do to keep us well in mind, body, and spirit. Mm-hmm. One practice that was mentioned is gratitude, taking a moment each day to reflect on the things that we can be grateful for. In addition, there was a theme around generosity of spirit, which I thought was really powerful. And a couple people mentioned that in different ways. And that had a theme around, you know, not trying to impose our will on others and being generous, assuming generous intent of others, having an open heart and open mind with others, and not just, you know, looking to great conflict, but where we can come together. And then just other ways that we could add structure to our days came up, as well as ways that we could strive for greatness through our daily habits and routines.
That's great. those daily habits, those daily rituals, that's going to make you the champion. So you got to work hard, keep at it. Thank you so much. That's great. Great feedback there. Humility, Bridget.
Okay. I mean, I know I'm biased, but I think I had the best group. We unanimously feel that servant leadership and humility is really at the core of servant leadership, and that servant leadership isn't always understood outside of our organizations. We've all worked at different organizations where it's very top down and I know all the answers, but here in our within our organizations and our leadership style, humility is really the core, and we're really proud of that. We feel like it was discussed that, you know, leading with a humble heart develops connections, that trust. Everyone's voice matters, that everyone has a power to provide insight and input. Sometimes decisions do have to happen quickly, and that's okay. But when they do, when we communicate that information, we've developed that trust over time, right? And so it's a good model to follow. Those times that we want to grab control, we get anxious, we're getting unsure, there's a lot of unknowns. We're proud of ourselves when we say, you know what, I'm gonna step back and lead with a humble heart and invite everyone around me to participate in the solution. And we feel like we're always better on the other side. So that was really a lot of what we talked about. And also we just wanted to offer up a challenge to everybody here to remind yourselves to go, after you leave today, to go through those people that you do want to serve better and just be thoughtful and intentional around some actions that you could put forward. Good discussion, Héctor.
Oh, thank you so much, Bridget and team. I really like that suggestion. Thank you for offering that up. I really appreciate it. I think it's a good advice. So the next virtue is courage. Joel.
So some examples of courage, picking yourself up from a difficult situation, like loss of a job and moving forward from that. We had some really good examples about courage of dealing with animals, like fear of snakes and getting over your fear of snakes by addressing snakes in the woods, or fear of bats when a bat enters your house and getting over that. We also talked about the courage necessary to deal with what we've all dealt with for the past 7 months, the challenges of COVID. And there's just many, many areas that take courage every day.
Thank you, Joel. So I have courage to get in the ring, but I don't know about those snakes. Different story. Thank you, Joel and team. Perseverance, Sharon.
Yes, Héctor, we were humming Eye of the Tiger. We persevered for sure because we were asked to identify three things that we could practice when we are persevering, and we doubled that. So really great things. I learned a lot from this group. They include prioritizing self-care, taking the first step, setting benchmarks and milestones along the way. So, you know, we talked a lot about, you know, you can take a challenge, you know, all at once, or you can break it up and take it into smaller pieces. Forget about being perfect. No one is perfect. It's not going to happen. Keep a gratitude journal. So that came up again in our group. And stay grounded in faith and prayer. And then always look at the bigger picture. Block out the noise. Stay focused and keep looking at that goal.
Thank you. That goal is important. Thank you so much. Appreciate it. Temperance, Jackie.
Oh, thank you. So our group talked about temperance, and the first thing that came up was more about role models, that some had very strong role models growing up that demonstrated temperance, and that there were others of us in the room that didn't quite have that same type of role modeling from our family background, and we were much more open in expressing our emotions, probably more than we should have been, but that ultimately as adults we need to make sure that we're looking at it from a relationship standpoint and preserving the relationship, and self-awareness is key to that, that when you can see it in someone else and you question it and go, is that, you know, how I come across as others, and just being aware from the beginning. So that's we looked at how we looked at temperance.
Thank you. Thank you. I really like about, you know, the idea of, you know, friends and others and family members that can help you exhibit those behaviors. And if you don't have it within your family, maybe you can reach out to friends or mentors or, you know, business coaches that you can rely on. So that is something that's important. So now I want to close this off, and I'm just going to read a few paragraphs of my book in chapter 9, Go the Distance. Can you do me a favor? We don't want you here. You spick, you N-word. Leave our neighborhood now. Adam's words played a significant role in my story. Those words echoed in my mind long after Adam shouted them. I was inferior. I was disliked. Those words hurt me. They frightened me. Would I have ever become a boxer if Adam had not called me those names? Likely no. Without boxing, what path might my life have taken? Would I have gone in the wrong direction, like so many of my friends with similar backgrounds? Hearing those words at 9 years old changed my life. Because of Adam, I learned how to be coached, how to be resolute, how to be a team player. Because of Adam, I rose from the boxing ring to the boardroom. And I thank Adam. And one thing I want to share here is, you know, some advice with what I just read is we need more forgiveness. We need healing. And look for those opportunities in your life that you can turn. Maybe it's a negative situation that you can turn into a positive situation. In closing, I want to thank you for being a champion. You are champions because you are making a difference in the lives of many through your roles. You are champions because you're going to use the virtues discussed today to make your lives better, to make our society better. The world needs you and these virtues now more than ever. And you are champions because you're going to purchase my book, My Journey from Boxing Ring to Boardroom, 5 Essential Virtues for Life and Leadership. It was a joke. But if you could buy it, yeah, I'm sure you'll enjoy it. It makes a great Christmas present as well. Now I want to stay, so you can find out more about my book. My book is available on my website, HectorColón, MKE.com. Or you can also purchase it on Amazon. So now I want to finish by saying, stay tuned for the 2021 LSA Strengthen Series webinars, which will be announced soon. Thank you so much, everyone. I hope you have a blessed day, and thank you for spending some time with me here right now.
Thank you, Hector. Thank you, everybody. Thank you, LSS Wisconsin team. It's great to see you all. Great to see everybody.
Thank you, LSA. Thanks, Hector.
Thank you.